17 U.S.C. 107 federal law allows citizens to use copyrighted media for fair use. That is criticism, news reporting, teaching, and parody.
Kuma, yahalo. Mea futu o ye beaka. Mea usu ni te meaka yupe meaka. Kuma, yahalo. Mea futu o ye beaka. Mea usu ni te meaka yupe meaka. Kuma, yahau. We are putsu o yveaka. Me anusa misaneaka mifaneaka. Arise of you, O Yahawa. Let your enemies be scattered, and let those that hate thee flee from before thee. Let all of Yasharah, Yisrael, who love, worship, and praise Yahawa, give him thanks by saying hallelujah.
So I've entitled this Treasures of Darkness because I want to discuss some recent dreams that Mike Adams of Natural Health News has had. Now, the scripture says of prophecy, ask of me things to come concerning my sons and the works of my hands, command me. So we're to ask Yahuwah for prophecy. And of course, you know, as I always quote in John 16:13, it says, how be it when he, the Ruach of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. So prophecy is for our edification. And so I wanted to discuss the Health Ranger report that Mike Adams does, and some recent prophetic dreams that he had, which really, I'm going to speak in the affirmative as though these dreams are true, and they, in my spirit, I sense that this is truly what Yah is showing him, and so I'm going to go with an interpretation that this is true. Of course, I could always be wrong, so take it with a grain of salt. But also, what's very revelatory is the dreams that his listeners have had. Adams is much beloved because he exposed a lot of the targeting of African Americans with vaccines and germ warfare, as well as exposing what happened around the AIDS drug and the terrible victimization of inner city children, primarily Black and Latino. And he's been very outspoken about trying not to get caught up in racial tensions, in particular false flag situations and scenarios. Like the obvious Wisconsin Christmas parade massacre, the day of some random prisoner's release, coinciding exactly and precisely with the Rittenhouse verdict. No MK Ultra mind control or bribing there. So I wanted to talk about the dreams and visions that Mike Adams has had recently, and he did a show on that because, of course, the scripture says that in the last days, Yahuwah, that is the creator of all, Yah, will pour out his spirit on all flesh, on all people. You sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. And of course, this also came to pass in the first Exodus. What has happened before will happen again. So we're going to discuss that later on as we listen to some of the dreams that are reported to Mike Adams. And so this is what I think has happened with Mike in this particular situation. And I do believe he's a prophet unto the Gentiles. He's very often predicting a lot of things. And he actually even states, you'll hear later, that he had a prophetic dream that came to pass about a fire or explosion a couple of years ago. But with that said, I believe this scripture in particular is what applies to Mike Adams. Yahusha, our Messiah, is going to receive Israel in the form of treasures of darkness. They are Israel. We are his portion, his vessels of silver and gold, because Israel's been reduced to dry bones. Cyrus, mentioned in Isaiah 45, is a type of Messiah, and he also points to the salvation of the Gentiles and their relationship to Israel prophetically as the grafted in. And I'll tell you why. Isaiah 45 says, "Thus says Yahuwah to his anointed, to Koresh, who is Cyrus." So Cyrus was the Medo-Persian king of the third Babylon that took Israel captive, okay? "Thus saith Yahuwah to his anointed, to Koresh, whose right hand I have held to subdue the nations before him, and I will loose the loins of kings to open before him the two-leaved gates, and the gates shall not be shut. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight, and will break in pieces the gates of brass and cut in sunder the bars of iron. And I will give you treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places, that you may know that I am Yahuwah, who call you by your name, for I am the Elohai of Yasharel. For Jacob my servant's sake and Israel my elect, I have called you by your name, I have surnamed you, though you have known me not." So Mike Adams is encountering treasures of darkness. And so what I'd like to go into is the meaning of these treasures of darkness. But we'll go into all of the symbolism as relates to the priesthood, the coming kingdom, which stones the enemy, Satan, has versus those that the 12 tribes of Israel has. And we'll talk about the dry bones in relation to giant trees and how we as human beings are trees. And Yahusha was a tree of life. And of course, how all of this relates to jewels, okay? And like I said, finally, who collected jewels? Esau, Edom in particular, and why? And so we'll also go into the darker prophecies that are revealed in order to make some connections. We'll get some answers. But first, I'm going to give you a quick preview of the darker dreams that some of the people who called in gave him, because even at the time of the Exodus from Egypt, it was said that people were given premonitions of their demise by Yah, so they would understand why and how they were being punished and how to escape it if they chose him.
But I wanted to start out with this photo. I'm sorry, it's an illustration that was sent by one of the participants in this exercise. As you can see, it's an image of a man, looks like a man with a mask, some kind of a mask that's bound to them. This illustration, was sketched immediately after someone had a very vivid dream. So ponder this image and also look at the despair in the eyes, the surrender, the sadness, the hopelessness. And the mask appears to be sort of locked onto this person, like it's a mask prison. And it's made out of some very strong material, perhaps steel or metal, like it's an iron mask of some kind with a locking mechanism down by the chin. So,
like I said, that's a preview, and now we will listen to Mike Adams' dream.
I do want to share with you some dreams or a theme that I've had in some dreams recently, just in the last couple of weeks. And I don't know why this theme is recurring in my dreams, because it's not a theme that I have visited ever before in dreams. But this theme that keeps coming up for me is large gemstones underground that are coming to the surface and that are emerging, and that there is this tremendous wealth of natural, beautiful stones. And I mean, sapphires and rubies and green and purple and amethyst, and I don't know what all the stones are, but I'm talking about like a field of them that you can walk across, or even a little cave where all the walls and the ceiling and the floor are just lined with gems and precious stones, so many that it's just an unthinkable amount. And in one of my most recent dreams, myself and other members of a small team, we were setting up a little camping tent inside a cave and about to go in a small tunnel under the ground that we were on, knowing that there were going to be all kinds of precious stones and gems under the ground, and that it was just littered with precious stones. And I don't know what this means. And I've never dreamed about this, and I'm not into collecting precious stones. This is not something, this is not a hobby of mine, for example. Although I do find them very fascinating. I love the idea, you know, I love the beauty of crystals, and I love morphic resonance, right? And the symmetry, Mother Nature, and gosh, the laws of the universe expressed through matter in terms of crystals. I am fascinated by it. I think it's incredibly beautiful. It's beyond beautiful. It's harmonic. It's musical. It's genius. So I am fascinated by it, but this is not something that I see on a day-to-day basis. So I don't know why this is suddenly appearing in my dreams, but it is. And if I were to take a guess, I would say that we human beings, we are so far just barely living on the surface. We're just scratching the surface of a realm of unimaginable abundance literally right beneath our feet. And we are so close to this abundance. And it, you know, the gems are just symbols, but it means abundance in terms of family and happiness and quality of life and spiritual abundance, not just obviously material wealth or riches like that, but rather natural abundance, you know, abundance through nature and joy and all the things that make life worth living, that all of this abundance is right under our feet and we're so close to it. And it is there, and it's coming to us. It's emerging almost as if the gems have to float to the surface and emerge themselves, like they cannot stay submerged any longer. And I think about all the suppressed technology and, you know, the med beds and everything else, free energy tech and all these things. And that all the suppressed technology is bubbling to the surface now of human awareness, human consciousness. And that if we could just be humble enough to allow this process to take place and to be open to revolutionary new ideas about energy and healing and medicine and the human experience and the spiritual connection and cosmic consciousness and all of these things, then we could enjoy this unimaginable experience beyond what most people would define as human. You know, it would be humanity with incredible divinity, you know, a godlike experience in this human life as we connect with God, we connect with nature, we connect with the abundance that God has meant for us through all of this. So that's what those dreams, if I were to interpret them, that's what they mean to me. But I just thought I would share that with you, because there's a lot of dark dreams out there, but I don't have dark dreams. I don't have nightmares. I don't have haunting dreams. I don't have horror dreams. I have, except the one time I had the prophetic dream I shared with you about that explosion that happened in Southeast Asia, that hit me very, very hard and very vividly before that event took place. And that was a couple years ago. But normally I don't have dreams like that. And I don't normally dream about money or gems or diamonds or anything like that. So this is a very unusual thing for me to dream about. But make of this what you will. And we are a community. We are all connected. We're all going through very similar experiences. And we are all very sensitive about the world around us, the people around us, and energetic influences, connections to others, and all of this. So this stuff, it's really important. It really matters what we are experiencing together. So I just want to encourage you, you know, seeing that people are having some pretty rough dreams here, some nightmares, some pretty bad police state dreams. From a practical sense, I think that humanity is going to win in all of this. Well, not just humanity. I think God is going to win. And I think God is going to hand the victory to humanity. But in other words, the globalists do not they do not succeed in destroying all of us. They will kill a few billion, but they won't kill all of us.
So what does all this mean? Well, the Book of Enoch, the Apocalypse of Abraham, but most of all, the 66 books of the Bible themselves tell us all about precious stones. In fact, Israel is considered the precious stones of Yahuwah, the Creator, a people more valuable and precious and costly than gold, is how Yahuwah sees his children. And so there are these examples of jewels throughout all of Scripture. And there's met a lot of symbolism that points to jewels. It's both in trees and in dry bones. Okay? In the death and resurrection of Israel after their fall and captivity to the four corners of the earth. So very clearly, Yah has blessed Mike Adams, because he doesn't have nightmares, he has prophetic dreams, and Yahuwah considers him to be very close to his own most precious children. He and various other people he's dealing with are camping out just above the surface of this particular chosen people of Yah, of which Mike is obviously one. And they are just waiting to emerge. And so he exposed the children who were experimented on with the AIDS drugs. He exposed them, obviously, with Kennedy. So Kennedy is one of these people who's camping out with him. And there are various other groups who he's camping out with who are close to the children of Yahuwah. Now, we're going to go into the genealogy later, but those who you think are the children are not the children. But in Yah's mind, this is how he sees him, and this is why he's getting these dreams and visions. This is how he sees Mike. And he very much sees him as Osiris because he's giving him these treasures of darkness, and his background is that he's a Gentile. We're going to go into Cyrus and the promise, the salvation to the Gentiles and their ultimate salvation at end times. But we're going to go into the priesthood of the Gentiles after we go into the symbolism of all the stones. And we're going to talk about Cyrus and exactly why he's a kind of Cyrus. But let's talk about the gemstones and their significance first. So what are the scriptures talking about when they say that Cyrus will be given treasures of darkness? Well, treasures of darkness can be found in the depths of the earth. And I'm sure that many people have seen these videos, No Trees on Flat Earth. And they very clearly display how what we know to be the trees on earth or the mountains are actually gigantic ancient trees. And down in the earth is the actual roots of the trees. And the jewels that we know of are the resin of ancient gigantic trees pressurized into jewels. Okay? And throughout Scripture, over and over again, it is very clear that we are fruit-bearing trees. Yahusha HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ, says that every single tree that does not bear fruit will be cut down. And this is the question that is asked when the angels go to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Are there any good trees in Sodom and Gomorrah? When Yahusha, who you know is Jesus, gives sight to the blind man, people think, oh, he only did halfway of the miracle. And then, finally, after that, the guy was able to see. Not true. At first, Yahusha put his hands on his eyes. He gave him sight. And he said, what do you see? And he said, I see men walking around as trees. The reason why he said that was because that's actually what he wanted. trees of life, fruit-bearing trees. And as we all know, Yahusha, who you know as Jesus, did not die on a cross. He died on a tree. Because he himself is the tree of life. And that's why he said, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you are not worthy of this kingdom. So anytime we're talking about trees, we are talking about jewels and fruit-bearing trees. After Moses wrote all the words of Yahuwah, he rose up early in the morning and built an altar under the mountain and set up 12 stones for the 12 tribes of Israel. Aaron, the high priest, wore the 12 stones of the 12 tribes on a breastplate when he ministered in the Holy of Holies and offered the daily offering twice daily. Each one of the sons of Jacob, of Israel, had a particular stone for his tribe. And so we see all 12 of them here. And the irony is also that HaSatan, Satan the enemy, also had stones on his chest. He had 9. So Lucifer's covering is on the left here. So both Levi and Judah, the priests are included in this. The eldest son is the youngest son. Even Joseph, who was the king of Egypt, is included in this. Okay? But the missing stones, the third row of the 12 tribes. So again, these are the sons of two of the concubines, although Issachar is a son of Leah. Really, Rachel was the true chosen wife of Jacob. And so these are the offspring of Leah, who kind of snuck into the bed, and the concubines. So in a sense, this is the humble adoption of the outcast fallen aspect, or someone in bondage. And again, this is the ephod that the priest wore when he went into the Holy of Holies to yearly atone for the sin, and also that the priest wore for the daily sacrifice. And each one of the sons of Israel has a prophecy over his name and tribe, which is symbolized by the stone that he wears. Okay? And this is read out on Jacob's deathbed when he blesses each one of his sons and tells them what the meaning of what will happen to their tribe prophetically. And this is tied to the meaning of each stone. And the difference with these last three is that they are very humble meanings. And so this is the aspect of character that HaSatan is missing. So God is told by Israel, or Jacob, that a troop shall overcome him, but he shall overcome at last. That's Genesis 49:19. Satan will never overcome, but will be overcome. Okay? Now, Asher wears agate, and this is, he's told that he's going to yield royal seed. Out of Asher, his bread shall be fat, and he shall yield royal dainties. Dainties are pleasure and delight. Satan will never produce anything that is pleasing. Nothing pleasing to Yah. And then Issachar is a servant. Issachar is a strong ass crouching down between two burdens, says Genesis 49. Now an ass is a beast of burden. And remember, that's what the Messiah, Yahusha HaMashiach, who you know as Jesus, he rides the ass, the beast of burden. And so Israel carries the burden of mankind via the 12 tribes. And so that is the difference between them and the enemy. Thus saith Yah, son of man, say unto the prince of Tyre, that's HaSatan, thus saith the Most High, because thy heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am a God, and I sit in the seat of the Most High in the midst of the sea. Yet thou art a man, and not God, though thou set thine heart as the heart of God. Satan has become a man, is no longer son of Yah. Wilt thou yet say before him that slayeth thee, I am God, but thou shalt be a man and no God in the hand of him that slayeth thee. Thou hast been in Eden, gold, the workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou was created. So that is what we know about HaSatan and nine of the jewels that he wore. The garden of Yah with every precious stone as thy covering. And we went into all of those stones. So I'm of an Israelite background, a Levitical priesthood background from West Africa. And so as a member of that particular tribe, I understand I could be, or rather, I have family members who would be part of the 144,000. But also all of the redeemed of all mankind, those who enter through the 12 gates of the 12 tribes of all of the sons of Noah's descendants, everyone will replace the third of the angels who fell. We replace HaSatan. What is very interesting here is the number 144 equals 9. And 9 was the number of HaSatan. He had 9 stones on his breastplate. And remember, Yah says he will cast him down, that he was amidst the stones of fire. So these are the stones on the altar that burn with the eternal flame of Yah, which is what the 144,000 are. And they are the foundation stone of the city of Jerusalem and the temple of Yah and the very altar of Yah. And so 1 plus 4 plus 4 replaces 9. And you know, Jimi Hendrix had the song, if the 6 became 9, I don't mind. I don't mind. If a mountain fell into the sea, let it be. It ain't me, because I've got my own world to live in and I ain't gonna copy you. Learn not the ways of the Gentiles. So as we know, Babylon will be destroyed by a destroying mountain not cut out with human hands that Yahusha himself, Jesus, cuts out and throws down against Babylon. And then that mountain springs up to create a whole new heaven and earth. And the ways of the Gentiles are no longer to be followed. Because anyone who is saved in Jesus, in Yahusha HaMashiach, is his Hebrew name, is only following the commands of Yah. The 12 tribe stones of Israel become the stone temples of Yah, and the precept for this again is in Enoch, and it says, again, I saw the cornerstone of the earth, and the four winds which support the earth and the sky. And down to 5, I saw the winds on the earth that support the clouds. And I went towards the south here at 6. And it was burning day and night. And there were 7 mountains of precious stones. And the middle one reached to heaven like the throne of Yahuwah, of stibium or antimony. And the top of the throne was sapphire. And I saw burning fire that was in all the mountains. So this is the mountains at the center that reach up to Yah, where Yah rules from. And there's, so this is the precept, again, the precept for it in Enoch, which can be confirmed in Isaiah. In Isaiah, it says, O afflicted one, storm-tossed and not comforted, behold, I will set your stones in antimony. So the same stone, and lay your foundations with sapphire. So the stone of the primary mountain is antimony. Sometimes it's described as crystal. And then the capstone is sapphire. And so you see it's referenced throughout the book. And when we look at Ephesians, it says that we become fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of Yah, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Yeshua himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in Yeshua. So our body is transformed into a holy temple in Yeshua. And so we ourselves, like the stone, the rock of the mountain, are stones being built up as a spiritual house to be as a holy priesthood to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to Yah through Yeshua. So we become like the stone of Yah. We are transformed like the angels. And we also become, just as Yeshua is the rock, we become like the rock. And just like an altar is made of stone, not cut out with human hands, you cannot use a chisel on an altar. So the human who is transformed into a precious stone in Yeshua as an altar unto Yah, because we know the saints cry out beneath the altar in heaven, they become a temple not built with human hands. Okay? And we know that the 12 tribes all have 12 stones whose builder and foundation is Yah. Of Jerusalem, it is said in Revelation 21, and the building of the wall of it was of jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass. And the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third chalcedony, the fourth an emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth sardius, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth a chrysoprasus, the 11th a jacinth, and the 12th an amethyst. And where do we find these precious stones? Among the priests unto the nations. So Revelation 21 says, having the glory of Yah, her light, this is Jerusalem, okay? Having the glory of Yah, her like was unto a stone most precious, even a jasper stone, clear as crystal. Now that antimonian stone is also sometimes described as a clear as crystal stone, which sometimes corporations give to their corporate heads with a capstone of sapphire on top. So it could be either clear or the antimony silver stone, which we see Thor. So, and then it says, and the wall of the city had 12 foundations, in them the names of the 12 apostles. And the length and the breadth and the height thereof, this is of Jerusalem, was 144,000, which is 12 times 12,000. 12,000 times 12,000 squared is 144,000. And so that is the height and the width and the breadth of the city. Okay, squared. And its foundation stones are of the stones of the 12 tribes of Israel. And so when we go into Enoch and we look at the Mount of Yeshua, Enoch 24:1, it says, from there I went to another place of the earth, and he showed me a mountain range of fire that blazed day and night. And I went towards it, and I saw seven magnificent mountains, and all were different from one another, and precious, beautiful stones, and all were precious. And down here to three and four. And there was a seventh mountain in the middle of these, and in their height they were all like the seat of a throne, and fragrant trees surrounded it. And the angel answered me, saying, this high mountain which you saw, whose summit is like the throne of Yahuwah, is the throne where the holy great one Yahuwah of glory, the eternal king, will sit when he comes down to visit the earth for good. So it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountains of Yahuwah's house shall be established in the top of the mountains, and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow to it. Family, this is the end sign, and many people shall go and say, come ye, and let us go up to the mountain of Yahuwah, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of Yahuwah from Jerusalem. A lot of times in scripture, I talk about fire, and we are being purified through fire. The fallen angels are purified through fire. The fallen angels, hell is a lake of fire. And there are a lot of scriptures that talk about how we're not supposed to send our children to pass through the fire through the God of Molech, but instead we go through our own fire of purification to remove all the dross from us and to come forth as pure gold, as pure jewels, which is the foundation of the temple, which HaMashiach is in, because we're the temple of HaMashiach. So we become gold, and that is actually gold and precious metals and jewels were actually what we were formed and fashioned out of, is our true essence and nature. And this is why when it talks about some of the Malachim in heaven, which I've shown in my other videos, their skin is compared to chrysalis and jacinth, and it looks like the color of fire. It looks like this dark chocolate brown to amber to maroon red. Okay, so it's dark chocolate, like here at the center of the fire, to maroon to amber.
Diamonds are made of a single element, so to speak, called carbon, and form via high heat and high pressure. And carbon is necessary for DNA and RNA. Now, the word diamond in scripture is Yah Halomi. The word diamond in Greek is Adameo, meaning unbreakable. Now, diamonds are excellent thermal conductors. That means they're able to conduct heat. And electrical insulators. They also reflect, retract, and disperse light, color, frequency, and sound. And the physical properties of carbon can vary depending on the allotropic form. So you can have a diamond, that's a hard crystalline solid. You can have a graphite, which is soft, black, and shiny. And then you can have nano forms, and they look dark brown or black soot-like powders. Saying all of that to say this, when you go to the book of Enoch, it has a very interesting description. So we know that the dark melanin or carbon is shown in darkness, or I don't want to use certain phrases, but let's just say it's a high gradient of melanin. Yeah? So the more melanated somebody is, the more carbonated they are. So if we use that same principle, and on the scripture it says, don't find it weird, the fire and the fiery trials and the fiery this and the fiery that, and the Most High wants to, you know, put you through the fire and refine you and refine you and refine you. That's the same process that a diamond goes through. He wants to refine our characters, get rid of all the stuff to produce a diamond. But diamonds and carbon, you can't get diamonds without carbon. So it's mutually exclusive.
Diamonds are very, very hard materials, and that's why it's used in the certain industries to cut different objects.
I was saying, what they've started to do now, when you cremate, you can cremate somebody and you can use those compounds and carbon and make a synthetic diamond. So you can crystallize a loved one in a diamond. So instead of having a big urn or urn in the house, you know, some people do that. Instead of having that, you can turn them into a crystal and walk around with your loved one as a crystal. How crazy is that? But everything is carbon based. We know there's a push now to go from carbon to silicon. They want to make that transition over to hybridize us. But that's another story for another day. Looking at this particular image here, who was kind of described like this in Revelation?
Just as you said about the silicon, they're trying to turn or convert into silicon. It's amazing that you said that, because the cheaper form of diamond is quartz. And what's quartz made of? Silica dioxide. So it looks exactly like diamond. Similar structure, how it is, you know, how the atoms are arranged in the molecule. It looks exactly the same, sparkles the same, but there is a different, one's a counterfeit.
So we're getting into some science here, but the science is complementing the scriptures and the scriptures are complementing the science. Yeah, there's bad science, good science. Let's continue and let's advance. So the nanoforms can be a dark brown or a black soot-like powders, for example.
Well, I do know that carbon is used in the arrangement of graphene. Graphene is like a single layer of carbon sheets. And graphene is used in medicine, like nanotube, nanotechnology, etc., etc. So, say, for instance, if you have a stencil, a heart stencil put in, where it goes inside your arteries to keep them open or something, in actual fact, you're inputting a form of carbon into you.
Okay, so that being said, now we're going to look at how angels are described in the book of Enoch. In Enoch 71, verse 1 to 12 to 13, afterwards my spirit was concealed, ascending into the heavens, and I beheld the sons of the holy angels treading on flames of fire, whose garments and robes were white, and whose countenances were transparent as crystal. With them was the Ancient of Days, whose head was white as wool, and pure, and his robe was indescribable. Then it goes on to say, then I fell upon my face, while all my flesh was dissolved, and my spirit became changed.
It's amazing. I remember saying this yesterday, how his flesh was dissolved, how you can be burnt up to the extent of just being in the presence of the Most High. Your skin, all your fleshy material just erodes away. Similar to that of if you've been exposed to nuclear radiation. And there's been a story out there of, I think it was three men. I can't remember the exact details, but I was watching a video about it. And these three men were exposed to nuclear radiation. And what had happened was, because they didn't contain the radioactive material, they, you know, the radioactive material just consumed them, literally.
Yeah, because in a sense it says, then I fell upon my face while all my flesh was dissolved and my spirit became changed. Hold that thought. Carbon, very black in appearance. Heat, pressure, over time produces a diamond. A diamond reflects, retracts, disperses light, color, frequency, sound. It also is a thermal conductor and an electrical insulator. More carbonated somebody is, the more darker in hue they are. They're able to tolerate the sun more. It's like a barrier of protection to live in unison with the sun. But hold fire. What's happening today in current time? So Bill Gates backs plan to tackle climate change by blocking out the sun.
We've mentioned that gemstones come from giant ancient trees and that human beings are trees. And this is why Luke 3:9 says, now also the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. And so, like I said, everyone is considered a tree, and the 12 tribes are symbolized really by palm trees. There's 70 palm trees in the desert when they escape Jerusalem. Jericho was known as the city of palm trees, and that was in the land of Israel. And inside the temple, there are numerous palm trees. Israel is also symbolized by the olive tree and, of course, the fig tree. Okay, the fig tree. But the palm tree is very important because it's inside the temple. And also there is a whole parallel with this idea of fire and purification and creating jewels. Okay? I want to make these connections for you guys with the dry bones, the jewels, the trees bearing fruit, and the kingdom of heaven and the fact that we are actually temples unto Yahuwah, the creator of all things. Scripture says that when the fig tree sprouts forth green leaves, then you will know that summer is near. In other words, when the fig tree starts to bear fruit. So Israel has been asleep in a deep sleep and has forgotten who they are. And when Yahushua returns, when Jesus returns, it will be for the 1,000-year reign. So that's from 6,000 to the year 7,000, the end of 7,000, and because the seventh day of the week is the Shabbat of rest. So the 7,000th year is the 1,000-year reign. So Israel was not yet revealed. That Israel has not been revealed. Israel has been hidden because the scripture says that Israel would fall by the edge of the sword and be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles till the times of the Gentiles would be fulfilled. Because there are various markers for the return of Israel, and one of them is they will dwell in a city without walls in peace until Yahushua returns and Gog and Magog alone, no other nation, goes up against them. Not like you have fighting in Israel today. Israel, the true Israel, Judah and Ephraim, are the fig tree. They are Yah's timepiece. So it's essential to keep your eye on the hidden ones. This is how you'll be able to determine the signs of the times and the seasons, and you'll be able to know when the fig tree actually sprouts forth its leaves. In the parable of the fig tree, Luke 13 talks about a man having a fig tree that had not borne fruit for 3 years. This is a parable that Jesus told because these fig trees initially will not start to bear fruit after 3 to 6 years. It takes a lot of time. Mark 11:13 points out that the time of the fig trees was not yet. So it wasn't the time for Israel to produce fruit back in the time of Christ. Interesting thing about the fig tree is the fig tree bears a heavy abundance of fruit, weighty fruit in all seasons. There is no tree that can beat a fig tree for fruitfulness. It can bear fruit in spring, summer, autumn, and even winter for 10 months of the year.
Here's what Jesus said. It was quoted in Luke 21:24. Jerusalem will be trampled on by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. Now, for 2,500 years, since Nebuchadnezzar's day, Jerusalem was under the control of Gentile powers, including the Brits when they had a mandate. But Jesus said this, Jerusalem will be trodden underfoot of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles will be fulfilled.
So why did Yah choose the Gentiles? Well, it was what Japheth did, and the faithfulness of Eliezer and various other descendants of Japheth. But it was also to make them jealous to return to him. They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God, and they have provoked me to anger with their vanities. And I will move them to jealousy with those who are not a people, and I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. For a fire is kindled in my anger and shall burn to the lowest hell and shall consume the earth with her increase and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. I will heap mischiefs upon them. I will spend my arrows upon them, and they shall be burnt with hunger and devoured with burning heat and with bitter destruction. I will also send the teeth of the beasts upon them with the poison of serpents in the dust. The sword without and terror within shall destroy both the young man and the virgin, the suckling also with the man of gray hairs. I said I would scatter them into the corners, and I would make remembrance of them to cease from among men. This was the punishment of Israel at the fall of the temple in 70 AD. This is why Israel would fall by the sword and be led away captive into all nations till the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And so here is the breakdown of the promise to Japheth.
Now, to be clear, the word says that Japheth, as I said before, would be enlarged and dwell in the tents of Shem. So Genesis 9:27 says, "And Yah shall enlarge Japheth, and he shall dwell in the tents of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant." Okay?
Who is Canaan? Who is Canaan who is currently serving Japheth?
So Sino was one of Canaan's sons, and then Canaan mixed with Gomer to create the Mao people. So those are Gentile and Hamitic people.
These are the Canaanites who are mixed with the offspring of the fallen angels, or what you would know as the aliens today. So this is the bad seed that let the fallen angel gene come out in them that no one else was supposed to mix with.
Sinim, the Chinese, a people noticed in Isaiah 49 is living at the extremity of the known world. They may be identified with the classic Sino, the inhabitants of the southern part of China, or Kana. Isaiah 49:12, a people very remote from the Holy Land towards the east or south, generally believed to mean Chinese who have been known to Western Asia from early times and are called by the Arabs Sin and by the Syrians Sine. The Canaan Winery, the world's finest winery from China. Now, when we break this down, Japheth's name, Yah, is the prefix, means Yah or Yah himself, God. But there's conditional because his second part of his name is Feth. Now, the word P is for panem or mouth. And we know in scripture, whenever somebody is flying in the face of Yah or before the face of Yah, like Nimrod was a mighty hunter in the face of Yah, that means he was flying in his face. That means he was offending him. So Japheth, it literally says the second word for enlarge is the same as the second syllable in Japheth's name, Pathah. So that means to entice, to deceive, to persuade, to allure, to flatter, to enlarge, a silly one. Now it can also mean in the face or in the presence of Yah, as Moshe spoke face to face. Now, judging by the fall of Babylon that has started and continues, they were flying in the face of Yah. But there are those among the Gentiles who will be able to speak to him face to face. If they accept responsibility for the sin of their nation and come into the house of Yah. Hallelujah. So it isn't just the negative. There's a positive. It's a test. Yahusha, Jesus, went down into the depths of hell, into treasures of darkness, to raise up those who were dead in the hope of him to life. This is where dry bones that shall become treasure reside.
So Ezekiel the prophet is the prophet of the dry bones awakening and the dead in Christ that is referred to in Revelation, who arise first. So in Ezekiel 37:1, it says, "The hand of Yahuwah was upon me and carried me in his spirit and set me down in the midst of a valley which was full of bones and caused me to pass by them round about. And behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Yahuwah, my Elohim, thou knowest. Again, he said unto me, prophesy on these bones and say unto them, ye dry bones, hear the word of Yahuwah. Thus saith Yahuwah Elohim." So how does this relate to dry bones and special crystals? "Unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live.
and I will lay sinews upon you, and will bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am Yahuwah, your Elohim." That is the prophecy of the dry bones. When Yahuwah sent Israel into captivity, they became dry bones. He said, "You will become as dung on the earth. You will fertilize the earth. You will be like dry bones, dead trees." And that's why when Jesus, Yahusha, went down into hell and he preached to the dead, then all these dead awakened and arose and went to heaven. So this is now going to happen again after the fall of Israel, after 70 AD, because Israel has been captive since the fall of Jerusalem. Skipping ahead, "And so I prophesied as I was commanded, and I prophesied, and there was a great noise, and behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone, and I beheld, lo, sinews and flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them about, and there was no breath in them. And he said to me, prophesy to the wind, prophesy, son of man, to the wind." So this is prophesy to the four corners, O breath, upon these slain, that they may live. So Israel was scattered to the four corners of the earth. And then he said, "Son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. Hold, they say, our bones are dried, our hope is lost, and we are cut off for our parts. Therefore prophesy unto them." But what happens is that he opens up their graves and he says, you shall know that I am Yahuwah when I've opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up out of your graves. And I shall put my spirit in you, and you shall live, and you shall be placed in your own land. Okay? And we will know that he's performed it. So these are the dry bones. These are the dry bones that somehow become jewels and gemstones, just like trees do when they're petrified and in the earth for such a long time. How does that happen, you say? Israel has not been revealed or redeemed to Israel yet. Israel, and by that I mean the seed of Israel. Ephraim and Judah have been hidden for the last 400 years. Psalm 83 says they have taken crafty counsel against thy people and consulted against thy hidden ones. Yahweh said he would hide his people and said, "I would scatter them to the four corners of the earth and make the remembrance of them to cease from among men. For the righteous children of good men did sacrifice secretly, and with one consent made a holy law that the saints should be alike partakers of the same good and evil. The master and the servant were punished after one another, like as the king, so suffered the common person." And that is Wisdom of Solomon. And so consequently, the 10 tribes and Judah have already gone to the cross. Salt is also a mineral or gem. There is a really interesting video on how they make this specialized salt in the Philippines. And this is, yes, the Philippians. When you hear about the Philippians in the scripture, this is what they're talking about. Because all the land that you see as Southeast Asia and China right now was previously the land of Shem and the land of the Hebrew. So the Chinese who call themselves Asians today are actually Canaanites, because Canaan begat Sidon and Sino. Sidon are the Chinese, and so is Sino. Sino-American Wars, Sino-Russian Wars, that's China. So the border of the Canaanites was from Sidon. There it is, Sidon. Canada is Canaan-da, and America. It's the West, the land of Ham. The scripture says, "Cursed be Canaan, Sino, a servant of servants shall he be." And Canaan begat Sidon. Sidon is where Mongolia is. This area was called Eastern Ethiopia, or Indus, India, okay?
not China as it is today, because Canaan's always dwelling in the land of Shem. In the Philippines, which was some of Shem's land and one of the places Israel scattered to, they have this salt-making ritual. So they have a bunch of Filipino Asians doing this ritual now, which they took over. Ends, right, that are written of in the scripture, they have taken over this ritual from the Shemites. They're dwelling in the land of Shem. But this is a salt-making ritual. And it, you know that Israel is called the salt of the earth. And so this will very clearly demonstrate how this process of purification by fire creates crystals and salt of the earth.
It takes us 3 months to do that.
Coconuts first have to be harvested, used, and then husked. After that, they're soaked for 3 months to act as a vessel for seawater. They are then chopped and dried out in the sun. At no point can these be rained on. If they do, they have to start from scratch, as this would reduce the overall salinity of the product. After 5 days, they are burnt and reduced into ash, or what they call gasang, which needs to be white. The gasang is then filtered into a funnel-shaped bamboo called the sagsag. This is lined with some leaves to act as a strainer. Seawater is continuously poured to leach out the salt or tasik from the ashes. This step usually takes 3 days and nights with little to no sleep at all. After this, the tasik is poured into special clay pots, usually hundreds of them, all lined up in rows over a special furnace. These are left to simmer, continuously replenishing the evaporated liquid as they go, also making sure to tend to the fire and making sure that it stays at the right temperature the whole time. This goes on for a whole day and is repeated as more and more solid mass accumulates at the bottom of the pot until eventually it cracks.
And so it comes out looking like one white, smooth stone. To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone, and on the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth. It is the heat and pressure of captivity and oppression that creates these valuable stones of fire. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. He shall gather his elect from the four corners of the earth. So the nations are currently feeding on the children of Israel, who are dry bones, buried treasure. Jerusalem, the temple, will be made from the body of Israel. So they are trotting down the body of Israel.
This said, Jerusalem will be trodden under the foot of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. So we are at the end of the age of the Gentiles. And the trouble in our world was prophesied by Jesus. We are seeing convulsion. This pandemic has reached worldwide proportions. Millions of people are out of work. Thousands of people are, not thousands, but millions of people are suffering. They don't have enough food. Now we're looking not only at a pandemic of biblical proportions, we're looking at starvation of millions of people around the globe, and we're looking at the possibility of nuclear war. What's happening is the end of the Gentile. This is the prophecy, ladies and gentlemen, that is controlling the world that we live in. These other prophecies are interesting. A lot of stuff's happening, and they look at this and they look at that. But this is the key. Jerusalem will be trodden under foot of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. And we are living in the most powerful Gentile nation. We are the fulfillment of all the prophecies of all the ages over the years, the great empires that have come and gone. We're the last one. There's not going to be another one. There's not going to be another kingdom. There's not going to be another Nebuchadnezzar. There's not going to be another Persia. There's not going to be another great empire. We're it. And this is the end, ladies and gentlemen. This is the one. So don't I mean, the Bible says when you see these things come to pass, lift up your heads because your redemption draws nigh. This is the one the Lord is getting closer and closer to the fulfillment of the ages. Terry?
Well, and you've always told us, keep your eye on Israel.
So it's really important here that I go more into the offspring of Japheth, Cyrus. In light of the other prophetic commentaries that are mentioned, and I'm going to go into, I thought I would explain other signs of the fall of the Gentile powers and the significance of Cyrus and those people who represent Cyrus in this time who will be saved. When you actually look at this illustration on the walls of Egypt, the original color is that most of them are sort of a brownish color to black, because those are the colors of the soil. My impression would be that they would have started out brown and then gotten lighter or darker according to the lands they were in. Of course, according to whether or not they were mixing with the angels. So Noah found grace in the eyes of the Most High, and these are the generations of Noah. Okay, and so Shem, Ham, and Japheth were the sons of Noah. And so here's what happened once they began to divide lands and look at their inheritance. And the reason why I'm going through this is so that you can see where Cyrus comes out of the line of Japheth and the Gentiles inherit the identity of Israel. Also, Jubilees 9:14 says, and the sons of Noah divided unto their sons in the presence of Noah, their father, and he bound them all by an oath, imprecating a curse on everyone that sought to seize the portion which had not fallen to him by lot. So from the beginning of time, they all agreed to be cursed if they went outside their own lands. They all said, so be it, so be it, for themselves and their sons and ever throughout their generations until the day of judgment, on which the Most High God shall judge them with a sword and with fire for all unclean wickedness of their errors, wherewith they have filled the earth with transgression and uncleanness and fornication and sin. And so we also haven't had in the mix, as I explained, a fourth man. And this is the offspring of the fallen mixed in with the seed of man at the time of Cain. That blood is still mixed in amongst the sons and daughters of Noah. Okay? And the sons and daughters of Noah were all descendants of Enoch. So here we have Japheth. And of course, the blessing on Japheth was that because he and Shem covered their father's nakedness after Ham went in and uncovered it, it said that Shem would be blessed as the firstborn son, and of course he, out of him, the descendants of Israel would come. And so I brought up the land thing because these are the descendants of Cyrus in the line of Japheth, and how they come into play is over land stuff. And so here in Jubilees 10:35, it says, and Japheth and his sons went towards the sea and dwelt in the land of their portion, and Madai saw the land of the sea, and it did not please him. And he begged a portion from Ham and Asher and Arphaxad. So from both the Hamites and from the Shemites, okay? His wife's brother. So he had married a Shemitic woman. And this is very important because it's a pattern with the Midianites, with the Medo-Persians, and it becomes part of how the Gentiles are grafted in. Okay, so this is the beginning of it. So, a portion from Asher and Arphaxad, his wife's brother, and he dwelt in the land of Media, near to his wife's brother until this day. So these are the Medo-Persians. They're a mix of Shem and Japheth. And he called his dwelling place and the dwelling place of his sons, Media, after their name, the name of their father, Madai. Okay? So this is important because in prophecy it says, after the fall of Babylon, everyone will return to their own land. So Babylon is about to fall, and we just heard a Gentile prophet say it, that it was over, okay? So everyone will return to their own lands, okay? So it's important to remember. Now, the next phase of grafting in comes with Eliezer. Okay, so when we look at the genealogy of Japheth, a really important thing to note and compare is the sons of promise in his line are this in the same birth order as the sons of promise in the line of Israel, in the line of Jacob. So his third and fourth son are his priestly line, okay? And the third and fourth son, of course, of Israel or Jacob are Levi and Judah, okay? So here's the genealogy, and it says that the sons of Japheth are Gomer, Magog, and Madai, and Yavan, and Tubal, and Meshech, and Tiras. And, of course, the sons of Gomer are Ashkenaz, and Rephath, etc. It goes into... But when we look at the sons of Madai and Yavan, we see in the line of Yavan, Elisha. Now, Elisha means God of the coming one, okay? God of the coming one, all right? And so it's interesting that even from this line descends those of Tarshish in Spain. And they're supposed to help repatriate Israel back to the land, okay? Elisha, there was a prophet Elijah among the Israelites. And the servant of Abraham's name was Eliezer. So Eli means angel, okay? And of course, Madai, the third son of Japheth, are the Medo-Persians. And that's the line that Cyrus also comes out of. Cyrus comes out of Madai, the third son, the priestly line, okay? Priestly line. Number three is Trinity Priest, okay? So Madai, the Medo-Persians, is where Cyrus comes out of. And notice how Magog, Gog and Magog, that's Russia, okay? And so, and Gomer is Ashkenaz, okay? Ashkenazi. So we can see from looking at this that the Ashkenazis are descendants of Japheth, and Gog and Magog are descendants of Japheth, okay? But the Medo-Persian priestly line of Cyrus, which we see Mike seems to be walking out, comes from the third son, okay? Just like Levi came from the third son of Jacob and Elisha. And we also know that Abraham had a servant named Eliezer who was from Damascus. Now, Damascus, so that would mean that was in the land of Madai. And of course, during the Medo-Persian captivity, Esther marries King Osiris. So Midian married to the Persians. Again, the Persians were Shemites and the Midianites were Gentiles. Okay, they were descendants largely of Japheth. And so Esther marries King Osiris and they have a child named Cyrus, who is prophesied to rebuild the second temple and to be a type of Yahusha, a type of Jesus, okay? And so he says about Cyrus, who is grafted in with the Shemites, I will give you treasures of darkness and hidden riches of the secret places, that you may know that I, Yahuwah, call you by name, and I am Elohai of Israel, okay? For Jacob, my servant's sake, I have called you by name, and I have surnamed you, though you have known me not. And so this is how the Gentiles were grafted in. And the scripture says it's one law for Israel and one law for the stranger among you. And that can be the Gentile who marries you or who is living amongst you with their families. You have the same law because all three sons of Noah were allowed to be grafted in from the beginning. When you read the scripture, you find that Abraham has servants from both. He has Eliezer, and he has servants from Ham's line living amongst him. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all the way through. And so they all have to live under Torah. But this is about the grafting in of the Gentiles, of Japheth. So here's some more. Now it says here, we've talked about Eliezer being the servant of Abraham, and Abraham actually asking if he should get his inheritance. Okay? And in a sense, he actually does get it. So Elijah here, Elijah means God is salvation, the servant of Yah. The prophet Elijah comes upon the king of Damascus, king of Syria, who was sick. And they bring Elijah, the man of God, to him. And what Elijah does is he cures him of leprosy. He has white leprosy on his skin. Okay? And what happens is that Elijah's servant tries to profit off of it and ends up getting the leprosy. But here's an encounter between the man of God and the king of Damascus. So after so many years of worshiping the Babylonian gods, the fallen ones, the great whites, this king of Damascus has leprosy. And so now his skin returns to its normal color, being healed by Elisha. Also at the time of Paul the Apostle, the ministry to the Gentiles begins in Damascus. Not in Rome, like everybody thinks, because the Romans are a mix of Chittim, and Esau, Edom. That's who the Romans are. But the people of Damascus are a mix of Shem and Israel. So this is where Paul begins the ministry of Yahusha, who you know as Jesus. So it says, the Apostle Paul in Acts 9 journeyed and came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined about him a bright light from heaven. And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man. But they led him by the hand and brought him where? To Damascus. To Damascus. And he says that he was the apostle to the Gentiles. So this is the beginning of it. And it came to pass that as I made my journey and was come nigh unto Damascus, about noon, suddenly there shone from heaven a great light. So here's all of the references. He's telling the story of how Yah revealed himself to him on the road to Damascus, on the road to the Gentiles. And I said, what shall I do, Yahuwah? And Yahuwah said to me, arise and go into Damascus, and there it shall be told thee all the things that are appointed for thee to do. So this, the salvation of the Gentiles began after Yahusha, because he said, I came but for the lost children of Israel. And then the ministers to the Gentiles are the 12 apostles and the 12 tribes. So this was the beginning of the Gentiles becoming Israel for a season. Now, the sign of the times of the Gentiles ending isn't just the fall of Babylon, which is the ultimate sign, but the other one is the fall of Damascus, okay? And this is how we know who the real children of Israel are not, because it says, the scripture says that when Damascus waxes feeble, Isaiah 17:1, the burden of Damascus, behold, Damascus is taken away from being a city, and it will be a ruinous of heap. The fortress also shall cease from Ephraim, and the kingdom from Damascus, and the remnant of Syria, and they shall be as the glory of the children of Israel, saith the Most High. Okay, continue, Jeremiah 49. Damascus is waxed feeble and turneth herself to flee. Fear had seized her, anguish and sorrows have taken her as a woman in travail. Damascus is the oldest Gentile city in the world. It was 3,000 years old, and it was destroyed in 2014. It was considered the jewel of Yah, just like today, America was called a golden cup in the hand of Yahuwah. He said, Babylon was a golden cup in my hand.
We are the fulfillment of all the prophecies of all the ages over the years, the great empires that have come and gone. We're the last one. There's not going to be another one. There's not going to be another kingdom. There's not going to be another Nebuchadnezzar. There's not going to be another Persia. There's not going to be another great empire. We're it. And this is the end, ladies and gentlemen. This is the one. So the Bible says, when you see these things come to pass, lift up your heads, because your redemption draws nigh.
All right. So what Yah says is, I will break also the bar of Damascus and cut off the inhabitant from the plain of Avon and him that holdeth the scepter of the house of Edom. And so who is Edom? Well, I'm going to let you guys know in a minute. He mixed in with the Italians, with Ashkenaz, with Sidon, the Chinese. We're going to show him to you in a minute. Second Ezra says, Esau is the end of the world, and Jacob, or Israel, is the beginning of it that followeth. In other words, the beginning of the world without end. And the people of Syria shall go into captivity unto Kir, saith Yahuwah. So the fall of Damascus happened in 2014. Didn't happen before 1945-49. It happened in 2014. And that was a judgment against them. Why? Amos 1:1 says, for three transgressions of Damascus and for four, I will not turn away the punishment thereof. Because they have threshed Gilead, that's Israel, with threshing instruments of iron, and they have carried away the whole captivity. Thus saith Yahuwah, for three transgressions of Damascus, for four, I will not turn away the punishment thereof, because they have threshed Gilead with threshing instruments of iron. The Iron Kingdom is Rome. The Iron Kingdom is Gog and Magog. You see, they are called the Iron Curtain because they carried away the captive, the whole captivity. They carried away captive, the whole captivity to deliver them up to Edom and remembered not the brotherly covenant. So they had a brotherly covenant with Israel through Esther, through Eliezer, through Madai, through being healed by Elisha. They had a relationship, and through the son that came forth, Cyrus. Okay? So this is, and they enabled Edom to carry away captive. They allowed Edom to carry away captive Israel. Okay, so they are being judged. That's why Damascus fell. And that will cascade towards all of the Gentiles now. However, as Yahusha is coming and it's all the end of time, those who remain in Yahusha and love his children will be saved. Okay? And so this is where Cyrus comes from. This is Cyrus. So people think it's Rome and they think it's Britain, and no. These are the Gentiles who began the relationship of promise with Israel. Okay? And so this is what our brother Michael Adams is manifesting as a believer in the Savior. So Yahuwah is giving him treasures of darkness. He is telling him that he is saved, that he is cultivating those gems. Okay? Now, I say all of this to say also that there in these testimonies, there's also a judgment coming. And so we're going to get into that because what happened? Damascus surrendered Israel up to Edom. And Edom also has jewels. So let's see what kinds of jewels were sold, and when and from where and by whom, so we can get a clearer picture of what jewels are. And this may help us to interpret the darker dreams that were related to my patterns. What's happening here is that the scepter is about to be returned to Israel, and it's going to be handed back to Israel. That has not happened yet. It is the heat and pressure of captivity and oppression that creates these valuable stones of fire. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. So the nations ruled by the eagle, that includes Nimrod's Babylon, Egypt, Nebuchadnezzar's Babylon, the Medo-Persian Empire Babylon, all of them were symbolized by the eagle, which is the symbol of Esau, the brother of Jacob. And the Arabian Sikhs, they went up to Eastern Europe and they enslaved the Eastern Europeans, including the Russians, the Turks, enslaved them, and that's where the term Slavic comes from. This is how we get to the final prophetic dream, the dark dream of some of the Gentiles, which I think is extremely prophetic. And then we will end it off with Esau, Edom, and the jewels that he had. As it was in the beginning, so it shall be in the end. Then suddenly, visions of horrible dreams troubled them sore, and terrors came upon them unlooked for, and one thrown down here, and another there half dead, showed the cause of his death. For the dreams that troubled them did foreshow this, lest they should perish and not know why they were afflicted. Yea, the tasting of death touched the righteous also, and there was a destruction of the multitude in the wilderness, but the wrath endured not long. So this warning was to the Egyptians, the Gentiles, the mixed multitude, even in the desert. They were given visions. Everyone was given dreams and visions to warn them about what was going to happen so that they could repent. And even the righteous died, because some are to be sacrificed and will rise first. The dead who die as a sacrifice will rise first. So we're going to listen to this last dream in Mike's Dreams and Visions Annals to get an understanding of exactly what it is that the Gentiles will be dealing with in these end times. And that's everyone who doesn't choose Yahusha.
But I wanted to start out with this photo. I'm sorry, it's an illustration that was sent by one of the participants in this exercise. As you can see, it's an image of a man, looks like a man, with a mask, some kind of a mask that's bound to them. This illustration, was sketched immediately after someone had a very vivid dream. So ponder this image and also look at the despair in the eyes, the surrender, the sadness, the hopelessness. And the mask appears to be sort of locked onto this person, like it's a mask prison. And it's made out of some very strong material, perhaps steel or metal, like it's an iron mask of some kind with a locking mechanism.
So it has nothing to do with health, it has to do with enslaving and binding people. I'm going to read for you the dream from this particular person, and then I'll share many other dreams with you here. And I want you to note what many of these dreams have in common is large groups of people, large crowds of people who are in a state of desperation. It's a very common element in these dreams. From a listener, in this dream I saw thousands of people waiting in two lines. It was nighttime, with the only light provided by bonfires and burning oil. In one line, people were waiting to volunteer to hang themselves on a giant tree with nooses, placidly waiting to commit suicide so that the others would have air to breathe. In the other line were thousands of people waiting with masks on their faces to enter what looked like an enormous tent that was filled with clean, breathable air. In the dream, people would pay the equivalent of 3 months of wages for the opportunity to take off the mask and breathe just a few moments of clean air. What was indicated and very clear in this dream was that there was an airborne pathogen. There were images of creeks and rivers clogged with face masks. The dream morphed from the fresh air tent and suicide trees to a situation in the city, all at night. I recall realizing I was so glad to have a pair of heavy boots on my feet, as there was sewage and live wires scattered everywhere. I saw an upside-down McDonald's sign, pipes gushing with sewage onto the streets, and again small bonfires illuminating the horrific scenes. I was with a few people, I do not know who they were, but there was a perilous moment when the decision had to be made to stay or go run for the hills to save ourselves. It was clear from the feeling that it would be a final decision with no return. Of course, I ran.
So there are those who will be faithful to Yah and his children who will be blessed, and others who won't and who will be cursed. And here is an indication of where things are going. This is Esau, Edom, the enemy of Israel, and the end of the world. And these are his jewels. According to the Archivio General de India, Sevilla, Spain, monarchs Ferdinand and Jezebel, that they should make sure that all slaves going to the New World should be from Spain. It is said that Isabella and Ferdinand, or Jezebel and Ferdinand, finance the slave trade by selling their jewels. Here are their jewels. These are the Holy Roman Emperors. This is Edom. This is true Edom.
These are the Medicis. Esau, Edom, who started the transatlantic slave trade, is black. And the dry bones in the catacombs all over Western Europe are the consequences of the Spanish Inquisition. Their Spanish Inquisition and the transatlantic slave trade. See the true Medo-Persians, the true Cyrus, are now coming against this Babylon, and they will not take silver or gold. They want vengeance. As for the chariot in which were the black horses, they went to the land of the north, and the white went after them. And he cried out and spoke to me, saying, Behold, these go to the land of the north, and they have quieted my name in the land of the north.